The World Bank votes to change its internal guidelines to free up to $30 billion in additional lending capacity over the next decade. The financial institution's International Bank for Reconstruction and Development arm also lowering its equity to lending ratio by 1 percentage point to 18%, taking on a bit more risk. World Bank President Ajay Banga says the move, coupled with changes in pricing policies, means the bank has increased its lending capacity by a total of $150 billion.
Next, there's something called the Capital Adequacy Framework in the G20 effort as part of the reform agenda when I joined. And that was meant to squeeze the balance sheet so you could take more out of it. Also meant to create new financial instruments that shareholders could contribute into. So a combination of squeezing the balance sheet through equity to loan ratios, but also through hybrid capital and portfolio guarantees has led to, I think, including what we just got today, probably close to $150 billion of more capacity to lend over the coming 7 to 10 years.
Meanwhile, civil society organizations from more than 50 countries launch a global day of action in the lead up to the annual meetings of the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund in Washington, D.C. They say the 80th anniversary of the international financial institutions is no cause for celebration, with their policies being blamed for a worsening debt catastrophe for the global south. The Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, or OPEC, further trims forecasts for global oil growth demand this year and next. Now, this marks the group's third consecutive month of downward revision in its October oil market report. OPEC projected a global oil demand growth of 1.93 million barrels per day for 2024. That is down by 106,000 barrels per day from the growth of 2 million barrels per day expected last month. Now, despite a downward revision, OPEC said this year's world oil demand growth is still well above the historical average of 1.4 million barrels per day seen pre-pandemic. An economist believes it is unlikely for the Philippine Central Bank to adopt an aggressive approach in its next policy meeting set later today. That's October 16. Now, some analysts expect the Banco Central to follow up its previous 25 basis point rate cut with a jumbo rate reduction amid easing inflation. But BPI lead economist Emilio Neri Jr. believes the BSP will only opt for a modest 25 basis point rate cut. This amid possible threats of supply disruptions, a potential La Niña event, and a worsening conflict in the Middle East. He notes a gradual reduction in the policy rate would help the economy withstand the impact of these risks in case they materialize. A real estate firm is optimistic another round of rate cuts by the Philippine Central Bank will revive the demand for residential homes. Andrea Taguines has more.
Real estate firm Colliers is optimistic a second possible interest rate cut by the Philippine Central Bank this year will help revive demand for residential units, especially in Metro Manila. However, it said the impact of such a move may only be felt by the middle of 2025.
It will not immediately result in lower mortgage rates. The average mortgage rate right now is about 8.3%, so that's still elevated. That's still pretty high. And that has been resulting in lower take-up of residential units.
According to Bondoc, about 60% of the more than 21,000 ready-for-occupancy or RFO units in NCR remain unsold due to elevated mortgage rates. These are the mid-income price projects, which he said even OFWs are wary of buying despite high remittances.
During the POGO demand, they were acquiring residential units because some developers told them, if you buy now, and it's once it's turned over, you can lease it out to the Airbnb market or the POGO sector. That's how what they promised to the OFW investors. Now, then the developers, they can no longer promise these demand drivers.
But even if mortgage rates start coming down, Colliers projects that it may take up to 5 years for the Metro Manila market to fully absorb the ready-for-occupancy units, given the permanent exit of Philippine offshore gaming operators or POGOs. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., in his most recent State of the Nation address, had ordered a total POGO ban effective by the end of the year.
That is also the same length of time we are projecting for the office market to fully absorb the vacated office space, which currently is at 2.6 million square meters.
The vacancy rate for office spaces was at 18.3% in the first half of 2024, from a pre-pandemic rate of 4-5%. In response to this, Bondoc said developers have adjusted by launching more upscale and luxury projects, as well as leisure-centric condo hotels, which is where the demand is at.
The demand in Metro Manila is slowing down, but we're seeing the shift to suburbia. If you look at the leisure-centric condo hotels in Batangas, in Davao, in Palawan, those projects are doing very well.
For an economist, another area to watch out for in the next 5 to 10 years is the Luzon Economic Corridor. Dr. Bernardo Villegas believes more American and Japanese chip factories will be relocating there from China amid ongoing geopolitical tensions.
The Americans and the Japanese are planning to invest a lot of money from Batangas to Manila to Bataan in railways, in energy plants, and in other infrastructures that will create a mini Vietnam in that area. So a lot more semiconductor companies will be located in that region. And that will be a tremendous opportunity for more real estate projects.
But he did cite the need to address high power costs in the Philippines to attract more foreign investors, saying the Marcos administration's nuclear push is a step in the right direction. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Tourism Department attributes a botched advertorial of the Banaue Rice Terraces to a private agency. Senator Loren Legarda questioned Tourism Chief Cristina Frasco on the matter during the agency's budget briefing Tuesday. The DOT says the ad erroneously labeling the Banaue Rice Terraces in Ifugao as part of Benguet Province was made by IPG Media Brands. The agency also assured senators it now has a tedious process in place to prevent a repeat of the same mistake. The erroneous ad went viral on social media last July.
The DOT branding unit, Madam Chair, which outsourced the placement of the erroneous advertorial material. Yeah. And so when the matter was brought to our attention, the erroneous material was taken down in the immediate.
Yeah.
And a comprehensive sweep of all materials in the thousands all over the world was conducted.
The Philippine Tourism Department wants to make the country a regional health and wellness hub as it eyes a bigger slice of the $800 billion global market. Jackie Pascual tells us more.
The Philippines is hosting the International Health and Wellness Tourism Congress as it eyes to become a regional health and wellness hub. Tourism Secretary Cristina Frasco says the country is suited to become a major player in this sector because of the quality of private medical facilities as well as highly skilled Filipino healthcare workers coupled with low costs compared to other countries.
Napaka-competitive ng pricing ng Pilipinas in terms of its ability to offer health and wellness tourism packages. And most importantly, yung aruga ng Pilipino is really second to none. The ability to exercise genuine passion, care and compassion para sa ating mga pasyente ay isa sa ating mga napakagandang assets ng health and wellness tourism.
Frasco adds that there are about 250,000 health and wellness visitors per year. Most of them go for medical treatment, dental care, go to skin and beauty clinics, or visit a spa. The tourism department hopes that number could hit 1 million in the coming years. Market research firm and event organizer Agora also believes that is doable for the Philippines.
Focuses on the well-being and on the health of the individual. So this goes for spa treatment, for prevention of disease, and for the treatment of disease. And I strongly believe that the Philippines has immense potential in developing this segment and in becoming one of the world leaders in it.
Agora says the Philippines just needs to continue improving its healthcare infrastructure, push for talent development, and pursue public-private partnerships.
Within the next 5 or 10 years, this number can jump to around 500,000, which is a very substantial increase if the offering is marketed correctly and to the right audience.
Frasco says they continue to partner with various government agencies, including the Department of Health and private medical facilities, to further develop the health and wellness market. The tourism department says the Philippines is already among the top in the region, but it hopes to improve further.
Based on the quality of care that they receive, the attractiveness of the destination for medical tourism, we're actually number 24 globally. And number 3 in the ASEAN region.
There is our portfolio for preventive care, no? Meron din tayong napakaganda na mga facilities in terms of aesthetics, dental tourism, and kasali na rin po dyan yung ating mga wellness tourism destinations, pati na rin yung ating mga spa, yung ating mga nature retreats.
Agora says the global health and wellness tourism market is valued at $800 billion and may rise to $1.3 trillion by 2027. It adds the Philippines can get a big slice of that market if reforms and improvements continue in the tourism space. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
It's the holiday season, and that means for Filipinos, it's peak time for shopping and gateways. Visa's latest Green Shots Radar survey reveals a significant shift in how Filipinos plan and pay for their travels. It shows that 66% now prefer using contactless methods like mobile wallets and tap-to-pay cards, while 67% said they will likely get cards with contactless features. Now, majority still carry cash as backup, which Visa says illustrates that there's still some way to go towards full contactless payments. As for preferred destinations, a survey found that Filipinos look for leisure, entertainment, and travel, with sightseeing, dining, and shopping as key priorities. Singapore, Japan, and Hong Kong remain the ideal choices for Filipino travelers. The new operator of the Ninoy Aquino International Airport boosts Wi-Fi speeds at the main gateway. The new NAIA Infra Corporation said average internet speeds at NAIA terminals have increased, with passengers now enjoying speeds of 50 to even 60 megabits per second, with peak speeds reaching 115 Mbps from the previous 2-hour limit. The free Wi-Fi can now be accessed for 3 hours. NNIC also scrapped the need to provide personal information. The operator said it has partnered with PLDT Smart and Converge for the improved connectivity. Local airlines gearing up for the unexpected, in fact, influx of flyers and travelers in time for the All Saints Day and All Souls Day holidays. AirAsia says it already sold 50,000 seats on its flights from October 30 to November 3. The budget airline now advising its customers to brace for the influx of travelers by picking flexible flight schedules. Cebu Pacific, meanwhile, says it is projecting nearly 1 million passengers who are flying for UNDAS peak travel period. It adds the most popular destinations are Cebu, Hong Kong, Iloilo, Davao, and Boracay. The Gokong Wei-led airline also sees improved performance for this year's Christmas and New Year holidays, supported by increased capacity from the recently added routes. At least 3 airlines have sought approval from the Civil Aeronautics Board for higher airfares. CAB did not disclose said airlines, but says they sent the applications as early as August, a month before the turnover of the Ninoy Aquino International Airport's operations to the new NAIA Infrastructure Corporation. The agency says the amount of the requested fare hike is in the hundreds. CAB, meanwhile, gives assurance it would be fair in deciding on any airline airfare increase.
Asahan po siguro ng ating mga pasahero na pag-aaralan nating mabuti ito at sisiguraduhin na hindi naman, kung sakasakali man, kung kinakailangan talagang magpataw, ay maging patas ito, no, at maging fair naman sa ating mga mananakay na hindi naman din ganun kabigat sa bulsa, na nandyan pa rin mananatili yung promo fares para mapatuloy pa rin tayong makapagbiyahe.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. calls for forward-thinking policies and more funding to reduce the risk of extreme weather events. Rafael Busano reports.
As climate change intensifies extreme weather events in the Philippines and across the globe, leaders both from government and the private sector emphasize the urgent need to take meaningful action and reduce risk from natural disasters. At the opening ceremony of the Asia-Pacific Ministerial Conference on Disaster Risk Reduction on Tuesday, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. called for forward-thinking policies that ensure the safety and support to those displaced by disasters.
This endeavor aims to fill critical gaps in international disaster response laws, uphold the rights and dignity of affected persons, establish clearer obligations, and enhance humanitarian coordination.
One way for this to happen is funding climate solutions. Masatsugu Asakawa, president and chair of Asia Development Bank's board, says international institutions must step up to further develop resilience in the face of climate challenges.
We can enhance financial resources and knowledge for DRR. Second, promote budgetary processes that respond to risk. And third, strengthen the enabling environment for DRR.
Such efforts are already seen in the private sector in the Philippines. This was highlighted by Ayala Corporation Chair Jaime Augusto Zobel de Ayala, who said that businesses are now better at adapting to the effects of extreme weather events following Super Typhoon Yolanda.
Telecommunications arm started to invest in more typhoon-resilient cell towers. Ayala Land, in turn, a real estate company, continues to incorporate disaster-related data in their estate planning, ensuring our properties are resilient, sustainable, and valuable.
The commitments we make to science, innovation, and investments can fundamentally transform our risk landscapes and will determine the future of our communities.
Financing climate solutions and, more importantly, the collaboration between the public and private sectors is seen to yield better results towards preventing disasters and ensuring the protection of thousands of lives and livelihood. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.